Well, hello world, and welcome to another edition of the MMA Beat here on this Thursday, February 25th, 2016. Welcome. I'll be your host today. My name is Luke Thomas. You know me from, of course, right here at MMA Fighting and Sirius XM. To my left, Jeff Wagenheim from Sports Illustrated and the Washington Post as well. Can't believe that, but it's true. And then on the very end, Chuck Mendenhall, who you know from MMA Fighting as well. Before we go any further, of course, we have to give our biggest shouts to the man who normally occupies this space, Ariel Helwani, who is in London with the creative duo Esther and Casey, doing phenomenal work. So saludos to Ariel and the creative duo. Okay, gents, I mean, if we didn't do a beat today, there was going to be a riot in the streets. We have so much to get to. Without further ado, let's get right into it. UFC 196, everyone knows the story now. Rafael Dos Anjos is out. Nate Diaz is in. The mainstream media can't tell Nate and Nick apart. That's another story. But we can, and we know Nate's there. And after yesterday's presser, there's a lot to digest. But I guess I'll just open with you, Jeff, a general question. Do you like the choice of Nate Diaz?
Well, I think generally there were so many options. I think when you have Conor McGregor in the matchup, you can fill in with a lot of different options, and I think a lot of those options would have been fine. But I think of those options, I think Nate was the best one. I guess what I'm saying is that even if they had chosen someone else, mm-hmm. McGregor carries a fight promotion so aptly that it would have been fine. But this is Nate is not a great talker. He doesn't. He didn't really spew much poetry during this press conference yesterday, but once he's in there, you know, the fight is going to be interesting because of the way he comports himself. So yeah,
Chuck, what do you think?
Yeah, you know, when I first heard about the news, you see it kind of coming down. His very first thought that went into my head was Diaz. I was like, you know what? He was calling him out. It's sort of like a strange. Because it's a late notice sort of situation now, you throw in a guy who's just more of a block or marquee name like that, right? Again, who's going to bring that sort of edge to this fight and this matchup. And it felt like something that Conor McGregor would be behind. So I was like, I sort of hoped right off the bat that might be how they look. Of course, they started talking about Cowboy Cerrone, and then you see Anthony Pettis, and you start to realize, like, well, you know, they really can't go wrong, I think, on any of these. Ultimately, like, I feel like all of these are pretty good options. But when it really comes down to it, when you're just talking about an event, especially sort of a cobbled-together makeshift event that still has to be big because it's still going to be in that headlining space, which we were sort of slowly understanding. They wanted to keep him in the headlining space regardless of the belt was there and all this stuff. I felt like Nate Diaz was the guy. And I felt like, when they made that announcement, I felt like the there was like this giddiness that went up over social media, you know what I mean? And it was like, it was all over the place. And then they have the press conference, and you see the numbers it did there. So I feel like that was the best choice. And you know what, man? People sort of discount Diaz in these situations, and it depends on what kind of shape he's in. But ultimately, that's a pretty fun fight to contemplate. Just in kind of honing in on how that's going to look, I think that's going to be a fun fight too.
You know what I'm amazed by is that people were saying, to the point you guys were raising, if you had gone with Cerrone, would people be upset? I don't really think anyone would be upset. This would still be something we would all look forward to. Right. But there were people who were, in my judgment, ludicrously suggesting you could basically plug in anyone against Conor and get this kind of reaction. No, you could not. That is so not true. And I'm not saying Nate Diaz is as popular as his brother, but there is something about, I was thinking about this today, you want McGregor to have faced a Diaz at some point. You want a McGregor and a Diaz together on a card, on a fight poster. The Diaz brand together as brothers and as individual units, but especially together, that Diaz brotherhood, that is a big brand in mixed martial arts. It's a brand casual fans know. It's a brand that we care about as journalists. To say that Nate Diaz is just the same, as I mentioned this on Twitter yesterday, as Taehyung Bang, is outrageously stupid. Am I crazy?
No, I think you're right. But I think there's two things at battle here. There is, of course, you want a fight that people are going to be excited by, a competitive fight. But there also is the selling the fight side of it as well. And I think that Diaz magically can take care of both of those things. You mentioned Cerrone. Now, Cerrone would also be an interesting fight, but, you know, if you're looking in terms of who's the guy, you know, Diaz beat him, so you would consider him a level above. Now, of course, Cerrone just came off of a fight, so you know he's in fight shape, and it was not a fight that where he took, you know, he took any kind of damage, so he would be certainly closer. We would be more guaranteed that he's going to be in shape to compete, whereas Nate is a bit of a wild card. We've seen him come into fights looking really sharp and looking like he could beat anybody.
His last fight.
The last one. And then I think it was the one before that.
Against Dos Anjos.
Was Dos Anjos, where he just was, where it wasn't just that Dos Anjos was really good, it was also that he just looked like he was lost in there. So, you know, what are we going to get? Who knows? But you're right. There is a kind of a magical ingredient. And when I saw the little fight poster that the UFC put out, which, you know, kudos to them. They put out this poster that shows like half of their each face, and each guy has. Oh, actually, I'm not even sure this is one of their posters.
I think was it the one where they're facing the camera?
Oh, you know what?
That was a fan poster.
That was a fan one. I realized that it was each guy's like flipping the bird. So
fan posters are traditionally the better ones. We're just being honest.
So I take back my kudos for that. But my kudos go out to that fan who did it, because it was a great looking thing.
I will say this too. You know, we talk about plugging in the right guy against McGregor in this special situation. Diaz comes to mind, and Cowboy Cerrone would have been right there, I think, with him. But man, I have to commend McGregor again. I just feel like they really go to him. And he's the guy with everything to lose in this situation. He's the guy who sort of keeps the event being an event. I know they have a good co-main event in this one, but he's the guy that obviously can just say, no thanks, I'd rather not. And he just goes with the punches. I feel like that's one of those types of things. I really believe at this point that he doesn't turn down anybody. I really believe him when he's like, if they say, hey, I have these names, that he's like, I don't really care. Yeah. You figure it out and I'll do it. Well, 170 pounds, fine. You know, whatever. I feel like that's pretty commendable in this game. I know we talked about many, many times about how that's sort of crazy. That sort of mindset is crazy. Like, you cannot blame guys for not taking short-notice fights and all this stuff. And we give him a pass, but here's Conor McGregor again, sort of proving to be like a guy who makes the exception, and he does it. And to me, that goes right into his intrigue of where he's at, and everything. It's like every step he does, it's a little bit ill-advised, a little bit strange, a little bit bombastic, but it all goes into this hole, and I think it's pretty commendable.
You know, he also is as adept as he is in the cage. He's also that adept at controlling the narrative. So look at this fight. Look at the worst case scenario. He goes in there and he loses. Well, he took a welterweight fight, so he's going to find a way to control that narrative no matter what happens in the fight. I mean, even yesterday during the press conference, he somehow twisted things around so that people walked out of there thinking, oh, Dos Anjos just bruised his foot. You know, like he says these things and he repeats them to the point where not everybody, but some people are going to believe that. And so McGregor is so good with his words that in some respects, I consider this almost like a no-lose situation for him. If he loses the fight, he lost a welterweight fight as a featherweight. He lost a welterweight fight on short notice. I mean, there's so many outs. Not to say that he's looking for excuses. I'm not suggesting that. But it's just that he's so good at controlling the narrative that he can withstand no matter what comes at him and find a way to come out the winner in some way.
I thought it was brilliant yesterday when he was saying that, well, this guy wanted the fight and then he tried to get out of it. And what he meant by saying they tried to get out of it was them saying they wanted more money or a more accommodating weight. Like, he somehow, this is genius to me, he frames people, his opponents, looking for better terms as looking for an exit. What a brilliant, brilliant strategy. But to your point, I feel like there are some guys in the UFC who will openly tell you, you know, I took a fight when maybe I was injured. I took a fight when maybe I was in a market I didn't want to compete in for whatever reason. But when you're Conor McGregor and everything stems from this incredibly, I don't even know how to describe it, but this otherworldly self-belief, it has this halo effect on everything where, sure, the opponent can change and the venue can change and the date can change. It's almost old school, but it's not this old school like code of the martial arts. It's more of, you're all a bunch of bums. You can shuffle the deck. It doesn't really matter. I don't think we've ever seen anything like that before, but it winds up being really good for his brand, his business, and the UFC's as well, I think.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, and it was a lot of fun to watch him because, you know, he has to adjust. People are like, how much material does he actually think of? And, you know, obviously he thinks things through psychologically when he's going against these guys, and it was really fun to watch him yesterday. I actually had anticipated a press conference quite like that one because it had been thrown together, hadn't had time to sort of marinate in your mind, like, well, is this going to go? It was sort of cobbled together. Here we are, boom, all of a sudden we're looking at these two guys, and it was like, it was all dawn on you right before it starts, like, wow, these two guys are going to come together out of nowhere. And it was fun, and it was also interesting because I thought both guys represented themselves very much how they are. Diaz is just a guy who's going to be, he's a fighter's fighter. He's one of those guys, very raw. He's going to just be like, throw his middle finger up at you and, you know, cuss you out, that sort of thing. But it was fun to see sort of the elevation of McGregor in a situation like that. Just literally getting giddy with like the exchanges. It's like I said in a little piece I wrote, like, you know, it's like he knows where the heat is, and the closer Diaz can get that heat, the more giddy he gets.
He's never had a chance to spar on those terms.
Yeah,
no one ever spars words with him. He never gets the chance. This was really the first time in the UFC he's ever had a chance to do that.
And he didn't. He plays with his food. I mean, he was he came out firing at Diaz, and when Nate really didn't meet him where he lived, when Nate kind of was not didn't have the verbiage to match him, you saw that he then kind of reeled it in and talked about how, I like Nate and Nick. I like the Diaz brothers. They're real fighters. So he starts out by disparaging the guy, and then he kind of builds him back up a little bit. And then just when you're expecting him to continue doing that, he starts disparaging again. And then he turns around and attacks RDA. And then he turns around and he attacks Frankie Edgar. He attacks Jose Aldo. I mean, he's
always canvassing.
He has the big picture. I mean, he really... I mean, he is so good at he does it all in order to further his fighting effort. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. Every single time he steps in against somebody, he's working them with jabs that are not necessarily physical jabs, but jabs that are coming out of his mouth. And it works. It really works.
Let's talk about this presser yesterday that, to me, was unbelievable. Really, it was the UFC's version. I'm going to say this. It was the UFC's version of Dada versus Kimbo presser, because I was at that one. At the same one, you had two guys on opposite ends squabbling at each other, and everyone in between making awkward faces and laughing out.
It's like three big heavies standing back there.
And then there was, and then the Dada and Kimbo one, there was cops, too. And this one, they had that chain of... I don't know what you want to call those guys. Hell's Angels standing back there or whatever.
Biker Huns.
The Biker Huns, hilarious. The Visigoths who were standing behind them. But it wound up, it worked. And it was also, to harken back to the beginning of our conversation, it was proof that when you mix a Diaz and a McGregor, you get a chemical reaction, right? You don't get that same one with every element. But to me, everyone talks about, well, this is fake and this is not real. Of course, this is a dumb presser. They don't mean anything. It's just for fun. But I have to say, when the UFC strays a little bit off their corporate, what do you want to call it, leaning, and I like their corporate leaning. I think it's good for the sport that the people who are in charge of it basically lean corporate. But when they go a little bit the other direction, it reminds me of the fun you see at boxing pressers. If you go back and watch old Mayorga fights, where he was, I mean, the obscenities he was telling to De La Hoya and the things he was going to do, this is the stuff that makes a fight even bigger. Do you like that they chose to do it this way?
Yeah, of course. And both guys are pretty anti-authority, ultimately, and that's what you know is going to collide in this type of thing. For instance, you know, Nate Diaz is over there saying, "You're on steroids." "No, I'm not on steroids."
Yeah.
Everybody in the UFC is on
the
steroids.
The whole UFC
and you're watching
Dave
Schaller, you know, he's right in the middle of it, and he's like, "Oh, man," you know.
Yeah.
Like, this sort of thing is hilarious to me, to see that kind of thing play out. And then Conor McGregor, obviously, does the exact same thing to the UFC, too, where he's like, he's all about Conor Inc. and, you know, what he's got coming up, and he's the one calling the shots, and just all this stuff. I just feel like you don't usually get two sort of anti-authority figures coming together like this, and that all goes into it. Like you said, I think that's the way of saying it. It's like there is a chemical reaction. I think that's what the anticipation was. When they made the fight and you knew these guys were going to come together, how will this play out? And I think it's only going to get more fun as they kind of go through with it.
But McGregor, you bring up the Diaz throwing the steroids thing out there. Now, that's something that nobody's ever accused.
That was McGregor. The one time, Jose, this is the one time I thought McGregor got the better of Diaz verbally.
Yeah.
He's going to get the better verbally, basically.
Anyway. Yeah.
I thought Diaz had his moments. I thought there was a moment in there where he got McGregor being like, "How dare you?" You know, and that was the first time you ever saw him have to rise back to a challenge.
But then he immediately, like that, turns it around and brings up his two training partners.
Which was brilliant. Which was brilliant.
So this is not. So we were talking about, you know, does he script things? He doesn't. He just is so quick. I mean, think about the way he fights and how he counter punches and how he is so sharp and doesn't miss an opportunity. He's the same way with his words. You know, Diaz throws something out there that was a haymaker, you know, out of nowhere that nobody had ever thrown his way before, and he has his response. Yes, he did have a moment.
What was Diaz's saying? Making gun signs with one hand and making a
balloon
animal. Balloon
animal.
That was
perfect. McGregor said that.
McGregor said that. Yeah, but that was just good stuff.
Yeah. And Diaz had the one part about, like, you know, I don't give an F about your belt. And then McGregor ups the ante and says, "I don't give an F about the belt." And then Diaz says, "Well, then why are you carrying it everywhere?" And McGregor didn't have the best answer except to sort of shout back over him. It went back and forth, but again, I thought McGregor basically proved that when it comes to this sort of thing, he can't be topped. But it was nice to see someone, we talked about it, if you just let him take shots at you, he'll beat you down before the bell even rings to begin. Let me ask about this now. Now that Diaz is here, you have to wonder what was left on the table. The RDA fight was important because of the stakes involved and because of what it meant. And because really you think that, and you probably still do, RDA is probably a tougher challenge for McGregor than Diaz is, although a different one, not long and lanky with his boxing and has that reach advantage that Diaz does. Is the fight now bigger because Diaz is here? Is it going to do more media? Is it going to do more pay-per-view buys? I have to say, you know, if Twitter is any kind of indication, and it's not, but if it was, boy, my timeline, not just with MMA fans, but the general sports world was filled with Diaz McGregor.
Well, I mean, look at what, when you say what's bigger, it all depends on what lens you're looking at that through. I mean, you earlier brought up the Kimbo Dada 5000 fight, which was the biggest, was a huge, huge ratings machine, but it was a farce. I mean, it was not to suggest this is a farce, but I think that the way we look at things, that look at success or what is a bigger deal, is often through what's more popular. And I think this is clearly going to be a much more popular fight. The stakes were much bigger, of course. I mean, you know, McGregor loses the opportunity to make history in this fight, but
a different kind of history, right?
Well, what is the history that he makes in this fight?
Well, geez, I guess we can get into it, but I feel like, okay, this is not as good as if it had been an RDA fight and if McGregor had won it, right? That would be the truly, okay, that's the number one. But this is like 1A, 1B, because you go and you beat Diaz, and tell me if you're, I think I'm wrong, you beat him at welterweight. Even if you don't think it's a credible claim, McGregor can spin it as a credible claim that he can fight at welterweight easily because he just topped a former contender. And if he beats Diaz, it'll have this, have the same thing happen to him at featherweight, where he had to go through Mendez unexpectedly, but that was your number one kind of guy. And I'm not saying Diaz is number one, but a real clear challenger, and then you get the champ. And at lightweight, you get one clear challenger, and then you get the champ. Mm-hmm. Either way he goes, he'll have three divisions of guys begging for fights. Well, that is insane.
I mean, I agree that that's a huge deal in the sense that he can spin things in his favor because he's so adept at that. But there's nothing that needs to be spun when you're walking out of the cage with two belts slung over your shoulder. Yeah. That speaks for itself, and that would be something that would have been bigger than anything he could have produced, other than the money. I think he could make more money on this fight because of the popularity of Nate Diaz, but I think that he's looking for something bigger here.
It's always weird because it doesn't always adhere to the symbols. Like, it's not like him getting two belts would trump every storyline, right? Like, I think back to the Orlando event, which RDA made his case by beating Donald Cerrone, and who was fighting before him? It was Nate Diaz. Who stole the show, really, was Nate Diaz. This whole promo that he cut afterwards, it's sort of like you're looking at, okay, which guy kind of carries the most intrigue in a situation like that? It was Nate Diaz that came out of it. I think that's what I wrote about after the fact, was I wrote about Nate Diaz. You know what I mean? So coming out of it, you're like, okay, Nate Diaz is a storyline by himself. It's just he cuts the better promo. He does all this stuff. So in some ways, you're like, and like you said, it's a very combustible sort of situation, him going against McGregor. I feel like it'd be a bigger fight. I honestly do, because I feel like this is one of those ones that it captures your imagination in a way that's not really tied to those sort of stakes. It's more about, like, this is just a fight we want to see.
I also feel like with Diaz, I feel like, how do I say this exactly? Because this is not quite true. I'm about to stretch the truth here a little bit. I just feel like with Diaz, it's a more real fight than people are giving it credit. They're looking at this like, you know, this is the fun fight, and it's a bit of bubblegum. It's not bubblegum. I definitely like McGregor's chances, but I like the fact he's facing a guy with a 2-inch reach advantage over him. Not the same kind of movement, you know, so you can't really say that's exactly the same either. But I just feel like when this is all over, we're going to look back at this as a very informative experience about who McGregor is. And when Diaz, by the way, discredits him, when he says, well, I'm the show, let's all agree that McGregor's the show.
Right.
But to Diaz's point, they didn't pick him at random. He wasn't selected for this bout because it was an accident.
True.
He was on the short list to begin with, and they were like, who can we sell, push merit, and sell a bunch of pay-per-view buys? It's Nate Diaz. That's the guy, right?
And I still think McGregor, too, just getting back to that. I mean, we're still, I feel like, in this process of discovery with him. It's a very odd dynamic for a guy to be in this position, but I still feel like with each thing, we're like, wow, can he do this? Is this possible? You know, like, so here he is going up two weight classes. That has its own intrigue. Obviously, he's more accommodating Diaz, so he doesn't have to cut a bunch of weight. But it is. So he's still like, you're fighting a guy that was behind a different partition. Now they're fighting. You get some new answers. Like you're saying with RDA, there was going to be a lot of answers to questions about him at 155 against a guy who'd just been kind of killing a lot of other guys, too. So I'm like, I always feel like with McGregor, each step he takes so far it's been like this extra amount of intrigue, this added intrigue. Whoa, now this is new. It's not, he's not going backwards in any sense of the thing. And I feel like Diaz still fits that mold 100% because it's, you know, they're fighting at 170, like you said, but he's also that reach advantage and some of his volume striking and all that, that kind of gets in, you know, you start to break down the fight a little bit. And it starts to seem kind of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you control the narrative, as McGregor does always, you are writing the story. So, yes, he's fighting at welterweight. Yeah, well, he's really fighting a lightweight who just doesn't have to cut weight. He's not fighting a legitimate welterweight. He's not fighting Robbie Lawler. He's not fighting you know, one of those guys, you know, Rory McDonald or whatever. But still, he's fighting at welterweight, and he can tell the story the way he wants to tell it. And everybody else has to wait for him to write the next chapter. I mean, everybody, the featherweight division has to wait to see whether he's going to come and come defend there. RDA has to wait to see whether he's going to, you know, he's going to get the title shot. It's almost as though the champion at lightweight has to wait to see whether he can get be bestowed upon him a title shot.
He transcends divisions. Let's talk about that. We have, we know what's going to happen with Diaz and McGregor, but everything else seems to be very much up in the air. Mm. You've got Frankie Edgar hanging out there, and you wrote the article. Frankie Edgar was livid. I've never heard him talk that way about being passed over, or at least, you know, the way the UFC framed his declining of the invite to offer to compete. Aldo, someone, a reader raised a good question with me, saying, "Is he even, could he even get a medical clearance to do that?" Presumably he could, although that's not a guarantee, but let's assume that it was, just for the sake of the conversation. Cerrone's still out there. I mean, he just won, but okay, there's still something to think about there in terms of future fights. What's going to happen to these guys, Jeff? Where are they going to go? That's a lot of moving parts. It's so hard to tell, but if you had to kind of game out what the next stage is,
it's really, where's it headed?
Where's this all headed?
I mean, get Conor McGregor on the phone. He'll tell us. I mean, really, it comes down to that, and I feel as though it's almost, whether he wins or loses this fight, he still, if he doesn't win the fight, he still gets a chance to decide whether he's going to challenge for the lightweight championship, or he's going to drop down and defend his featherweight belt. I have a gut feeling that he's seen the last of featherweight. I know that you've talked about this before, so you were way ahead of us on this one. But I wasn't quite sure about that when he was just jumping up to 155. But now that he's taking on a guy and he's fighting at the comfortable weight of 170, he's going to probably feel good about himself, realize maybe if I'm going to toggle between weight classes, I should toggle between 170 and 155, and I've already climbed the mountain at 155, at 145. I don't need to climb that mountain again. You know, people say you're not the champ unless you defend your belt. That's for that's for the chumps. The real the guy who controls the narrative,
Jeff Wagenheim,
the guy that
elite standard Wagenheim. Look at that.
The guy who controls the narrative is the guy who gets to decide the story.
And you know, this is exactly why Frank Edgar is as livid as he is, because I think he believes, just like a lot of the other guys, that he's not coming back. That he's like, well, what are we doing here? We're just spinning our wheels. You're doing, you know, you have the belt, but you're going to keep it hostage now by just moving off to these other weight classes, but no intention of coming back. So you can tell that's behind his, you know, part of his frustration is like, nobody wants to sit around and wait for you to make your rounds and then come back. And I feel like that goes into it. Ultimately, like you were asking sort of what happens with these guys. I mean, the clearest path, if McGregor truly is going to move up and he's going to try at 155, 170 now, and he's going to stay in those fields, who knows how long for which ones or whatever, but obviously, the most basic fight they could do for an interim title, if they choose to go that way, would be Edgar against Aldo. I mean, that's like at least they have that fight sitting there that they could put together. I know Aldo's been on record saying that he would only fight his next fight if it's for a belt, and I know that Frankie Edgar wants to avenge their first fight. So, I feel like that's there, but it's funny because I feel like still, even having saying, all the logic can stack up behind a Conor McGregor fight any way you want, but it still has to sort of go through like what happens with Conor McGregor. So a lot will be determined on, you know, what happens in the 170s. Last time after he kind of beat Aldo, he went and said, I'm going to move up to lightweight before we even got to the press conference. I feel like he could switch things just like this, but at least they have some scenarios like that. And at 155, you've got so many guys right now that you could plug into so many different situations. So it'll be very intriguing. I think ultimately I'd like to see McGregor go to 155 and see what he does there before he goes about to 170 for good or anything like that.
I am interested in this bout because here's another element of danger for McGregor that he's adopted that you really have to consider. What if Nate Diaz wins?
Yeah.
Again, I don't think that's the likeliest thing, but doesn't matter what I think. We'll see what happens two Saturdays from now. Because if you think about it, that changes everything. That might force him back to featherweight.
Imagine
in a way.
Him flipping off everybody like he did with Pellegrino as he gets the submission. Imagine that being Conor McGregor.
It would. First of all, it would push Nate Diaz into another big fight, at least, or you know, several big fights down the line, just as because of the, he'll have finally pushed his name, I think, more equal to Nick's. But really, it would do significant damage to Conor McGregor's ambitions. Because if you're out there talking about three divisions, and now you lost to a contender in only the second of those three, you cut the third out, the second one you don't even know about, and the first, I guess, of course, you can always go back to. Do you think that, this is what I'm talking about when you give praise to Conor McGregor, everyone's like, oh, this fight doesn't mean anything. This fight is incredibly important and super risky.
Of course.
What do you think is the likeliest takeaway we're going to have real quickly on this last one? We'll talk about this issue. If Diaz wins, what's the big takeaway that's going to happen?
Well, like you said, he controls the narrative just enough, especially in a situation like these. It's really hard to say because we have not seen him lose in the UFC. It's been so long since he lost a bout.
McGregor, you mean?
Yeah, McGregor. So we haven't seen him lose. I'm not sure if he comes with a strong game and defeat, like in terms of like, you know what, I bit off more than I can chew, if there's any kind of humble side to him that way or whatever it would be. But that would certainly, I think, put a big dent in his mystique. We keep talking about all this Mystic Max stuff, him calling his shots. I feel like we're actually sort of putting him in some other strata where we've never put fighters before, you know, like where this guy does have some kind of mystical ability. You always talk about his confidence. I feel like we are looking at a guy whose confidence is probably the greatest that I've seen in the fight game. Like, he's that kind of guy. How does all that change? I really don't know. I like to believe that he's at heart, he's a big-time sportsman, that he would handle his defeat at least in terms of how, you know, he would handle it like very classily, how that would translate into how people perceive him. Would that put a dent into him staying 155, or would he still get a title shot there? I have no idea.
My guess is that would then precipitate the merger of the McGregor Fight Club or whatever that organization that he that was announcing his fights and the UFC. Because it seems as though McGregor has been talking about, I'm the show, I'm the guy that I run this business. And the UFC, at some point, I think they've just let him do it because it's making the money. But at some point, pretty soon, they do need to reel him in because they do have a featherweight division that is sitting there, you know, on the treadmill waiting for the go-ahead to move forward. They do have a lightweight champion who pretty soon will be healed and ready to defend his belt. And, of course, you know, I'm not sure that the welterweight division is all that nervous about anything yet. It's, at some point, maybe they'll want a piece of him as well. But if he ends up, you know, we've talked about him winning. Well, if he ends up losing, then it's time for the UFC. It's time for Dana White to say, hey, you know what? Look, I'm the president of this company, and this is what we want to see out of you, and, you know, fall in line a little bit.
Y'all are crazy. The correct answer is that if he loses, he will spin it that there needs to be a rematch because it doesn't mean anything because of the late change. Guarantee it. All right, let's move on to the next issue.
I like the guarantee. That's
I have no way of enforcing it, of course, but let's talk about the second issue here we have to get to this weekend, Saturday, on Fight Pass, which I think is a brilliant call by them. I like it. The return of the greatest of all time, Anderson Silva, is back. He's going to be taking on Michael Bisping again on Fight Pass. Boy, what do you make of this? This is a guy who was reputed to be, if not the best ever, certainly on the extraordinary short list, and has this semi-fall from grace because the punishment wasn't too harsh because of the window in which it happened before the major USADA rules got involved. Jeff, as we approach Saturday, and I think this is a mega fight in terms of the consequences for the loser. When you head into the Saturday, what are you thinking about in terms of Anderson Silva? Is the public ready to accept him again? Are they kind of moving on because he didn't look so great and he's aging? Where is Anderson Silva today?
Well, he's not going to be very popular as he comes into the cage. He's fighting in London against a Brit. So right there, he's going to be walking in there as the villain. So he's not going to have the crowd behind him. That makes some... I think that has some impact on how...
And Bisping's never lost in the UK.
Right, 16-0 in the UK, which is pretty impressive. Of course, he hasn't fought in the UK since, I think, 2010. So it's, you know, it's been a...
No, he fought in Scotland last year.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
He hasn't fought in London since 2010.
London, I was
there. The Scottish did not separate. The no vote won, remember?
Oh, yeah.
Right?
That's right. Anyway, so, yeah, so... but I think that... So I think that Silva... I think that Silva is... at the end of his career, very close to it, and I think that he's talking about maybe having one more title run. If he goes out there and either looks not so good. I mean, he didn't look great against Nate Diaz when he fought a year ago. And he won the fight, he controlled the fight, and all that. But it wasn't one of those performances that harkened back to his glory days. And then, of course, before that, he lost two in a row. So he's hasn't really won a fight in a couple of years that's meant anything, that stood. You know, he did win that fight, but it ended up becoming a no contest. So I would say that if he goes out there and does not beat Michael Bisping, I'm not going to say that is the end of the road for him, but I think it's the end of the road in terms of thinking of him as like one of those MMA gods, yeah. One of those guys who is a relevant fighter.
Jack, real quick, I just want to bring this up as you answer. You know, it's interesting because you can take whatever road you want on Anderson Silva. There are people who are like, I'm kind of ready to turn the page on him. Our own Mike Chiappetta had written that I think guys who had come back from maybe the record of guys after 40 is 22 and 37, yeah, right? But at the same time, Anderson Silva's only lost to one guy ever in the UFC. So how right. When you headed to Saturday, how are you viewing it?
I've loved this fight since it was made, especially given where it's at. I thought everything was perfectly set up, to be honest with you. What's your boy, Booby Dixon, who was like saying when the Buffalo Bills were out of the playoffs, they were playing the last game against the New York Jets,
oh, right.
And they said, this is our Super Bowl. I feel like this is Michael Bisping's Super Bowl. Like, this is his moment. He's in his hometown and is fighting in front of his countrymen, but it's a fight he's wanted for so long. As far back as I can remember talking to him, Anderson Silva's always been pretty close to where he wanted to, you know, he's wanted to fight this. It's not for a belt, but here's the thing. I'm not sure maybe if he wins this fight, he will put himself in a position to maybe get that shot at coming up, but I get the feeling that this is like his title fight. Like, this is his moment to do this from his perspective. So those are the stakes. You mentioned the stakes. It's funny because they both have a very, very, you know, elastic stakes here. Like, his are over there, whereas Anderson Silva, 40 years old, has a lot to prove. It's 2012 since the Stephen Bonner fight when he won that fight, and it's just been really a vertigo for him since then. I feel like he's gone through some horrible things, and going into that last fight with Diaz, the big question was, how does he respond to a broken leg? Is he going to have mentally, you know, is it going to mentally affect his ability to kick? All these things, and it's funny that we don't even really mention that anymore.
Nope.
We're only mentioning like what form will he look in after being suspended at 40 years old and all this. Perfect setup though, because I feel like if anybody's going to accommodate him in his kind of fight, Bisping will certainly stand in there with him, and I feel like that the whole way, every way you want to look at this fight, I really love it.
I want to talk more about Bisping, and by the way, if you haven't seen it yet, I can't be more clear. You need to go watch Ariel's walk and talk with Bisping, because he says something in there very interesting. We'll get to it in just a second. But with Anderson, I feel like he's in a weird position, because one of my viewers on the live chat asked me this. They said, well, what happens if he beats Bisping? Is he close to a title shot, Anderson Silva? Yes. Yes, he is. That's crazy to think about. But with Romero gone, if Weidman loses again... Yeah. Who knows what's going to happen with Vitor against Jacare? I guess you could plug in Jacare, but who's going to sell more, the return of Anderson Silva or that? Yeah. And yet, on the other hand, if he loses, he said today, well, I won't be affected by the steroid legacy. I bet you if he loses, this is where Anderson Silva is.
Right.
Potential title shot or a legacy being even more impacted by the 100%. Steroid test.
Yeah.
That isn't, have you ever seen anything like that?
Yeah, no, it's right. You're right. The whole steroid thing, you know, he gets caught one time. And he says that never was a factor.
One time, but it's like, we found one shipment of your illegal firearms, and it's an entire warehouse full of AK-47s.
Right, so we have no evidence that he was doing anything before, but all we have now is the guy that presumably now is clean, because he's been probably being tested like crazy. And if he goes out there and doesn't look good...
Bisping said he was tested twice in the interview with Ariel.
Okay, so, you know, so he's being tested. And if he goes out there and doesn't perform... then there's going to be a lot of assumptions that are going back. Now, of course, those assumptions may not be right, because he's 40 years old. I mean, let's not, you know, I know you were citing the Mike Chiappetta story about guys of advanced age and how they succeed or don't succeed. Now, Silva is a particularly interesting case in that, because his whole skill set really is he has a young man's kind of skill set. I mean, he relies on quickness and reflexes and things that, you know, a guy like Randy Couture was able to go in there and just kind of maul people up against the fence, dirty box, kind of things that a guy who has a little bit of age on him can still do. I just think that Anderson Silva, that stuff goes away. That stuff goes away at some point. Has it gone away now that he's 40 years old? We'll see on Saturday night. I think this is a fight that's really tailor-made to test Anderson Silva, because think about it. These guys were fighting in their prime, in both of their primes. You know, Mitt Bisping stands up. He likes to strike. He comes forward. He's a fairly aggressive guy, just the kind of guy that you want to fight if you're Anderson Silva. But now, can he take advantage of the guy? And if he can't take advantage of Bisping now, I think his legacy is in trouble.
And on the other side of the stakes, you know, just the Super Bowl weekend out in Vegas, I talked to Ed Soares for a little bit about, you know, what's the realistic sort of expectation. I mean, he talks about it like that Anderson wants to make that title run. You know, he thinks he can make this title run. He thinks he can do it. And it's not like he was saying that, you know, it had nothing to do with the belt at this point. It had to do with everybody sort of doubting him and thinking exactly what we're talking about right now, that, you know, where is this guy? Can he do it? You know, he's gone. That's a bygone day. So it'll be interesting to see how much of that motivation. We know a lot of this stuff is people deluding themselves going into a fight, but would it be interesting to see it? Because imagine if he looks anything like he did, and he just goes out there and it's just a striking clinic and precision strike, and he just puts Michael Bisping away fast. That would be pretty big, making his case for another title shot.
Which would be devastating because, again, in that interview, I want to talk about Michael Bisping now. In that interview with Ariel that came out today, he says, Bisping, that if he loses this bout, that all the things critics, including journalists, including fans, say about him, that is, he's a good fighter, he's a decent fighter, but he loses the big ones. He says in the interview, they would be right. They would be right.
That's crazy.
Wow. What an admission by a fighter to say that before a fight. You almost never hear that.
Like, he's more media than fighter now. This is crazy.
Well, what he's also saying is that there's been these periodic moments in his life where he's told himself, you simply cannot lose.
Yeah.
You just can't. And every time that's happened, he's won. This happens to be, in his mind, another one of those. We'll find out on Saturday.
What a great setup, though.
This is so amazing to me because we talked about the stakes for Silva, the either-or. The either-or for Bisping is incredible as well. Another guy who, if he wins, to me, will have validated so much of the asterisks next to his losses because of the asterisks next to the wins of his opponents. And if he loses, I think Bisping is unfortunately quite right. I think many people will remember him as, you were a good fighter who, when it really came time to get it done, you just couldn't do it.
But I think that there's reality in that. I mean, I don't think he'd be cheating himself.
But it's such a sobering one. You don't hear fighters express that.
Right. Well, you wouldn't hear Conor McGregor say that, for example. McGregor will always. McGregor is filled with self-belief. And I think that Bisping has been filled with self-belief at times through his career too, but he's also seen he's running up against brick walls and had, you know, two times he was in title fight eliminators and lost both those fights. So, you know, when you're that close and you don't quite get over the hump, you know, it's tough to overcome. But I think Bisping is better at controlling his narrative than Silva. I think Silva has to go in there and perform in the fight. I don't think Anderson Silva can talk, I failed this one test, it was a mistake. I think Anderson Silva needs to perform in order to change the narrative. I think Bisping can talk a little bit around it and be a little more successful at it.
It's crazy, though, because when you look at Bisping's actual record, when you really look at his opponents, he stood in there against a who's who. Although he has not fought Anderson Silva yet, he has fought so many of these guys. But if you really look at the guys he should beat, he won. You look at the guys who are sort of in that top space, he's lost. I mean, it's almost black and white. Like, you go through his resume, and he has just dropped those big fights. So he's got, I mean, I'm sure internally, like you're mentioning, he's been very realistic with himself, because that has just simply been the case. And I feel like, obviously, like, this would be the biggest win of his career if he gets it, coming very late in his career. And it would open up that next big one that he probably wants more than any of them. But I feel like right now, that's what I meant. I just really believe that right now, all of his cards should be in this one fight. Like, get through this, because it saves him in a lot of ways from what we're talking about.
So massive stakes. Couldn't be higher. Couldn't be more interesting and more dynamic. Really looking forward to seeing how that main event plays out on Saturday as I sit on my couch in my bathrobe unshowered.
Drinking.
Saturday morning, right? Saturday.
Drinking Jim Beam and Diet Coke. Rot gut is the only way to fly. Let's move on to something else a little bit different outside the UFC space. There's a lot going on there. We're now, almost a week removed from Bellator 149. I, of course, was in Houston. I don't know if I have bed bugs in my clothes or not from the hotel I stayed in, but nevertheless, just parting shots at Houston, which is actually not a bad city. What are the lessons we can draw from this? Now we have the ratings, those are in. It peaked with plus three DVR at 3.3 million. 2.9 was the average for the main event. I think the co-main event averaged at 2.7 mil. These are ratings records for Spike when it comes to Bellator programming. And yet, a guy almost died in the co-main event. The rest of the card was not particularly interesting. Even the non-freak show element, Again, to be fair to Duke Rufus product, Emmanuel Sanchez, I really thought he looked pretty good. I think folks are going to be talking more about him in the months and years to come. But, Jeff, I'll just kick it off with you because I watched the beat when I was in Houston. You guys were clubbing Bellator. But you know what? They have both a strike against them and ammunition for their argument. Look at the success we had. Look at the danger we flirted with.
Right.
What are the lessons we can draw?
That's it right there. I mean, I think that I was thinking about my reactions to this, and my reaction leading up was similar to what we talked about it last week on the beat. I wasn't very interested in the fights. I'm not really into these freak show, or as Scott Coker likes to call them, the fun fights. That's not really that stuff doesn't really interest me. But I you know, as I said last week, I kind of give Bellator a different standard. It's not. They're not handing out championship belts to these guys. It's fine. Do what they're doing. But I wasn't interested in watching it. Then I tuned in on Friday night, and I found myself. I'd never watched a fight card with a big grin on my face for the entire time because I was sitting there, you know, on Twitter, you know, bantering with people, having a lot of fun,
just watching, hamming it up,
watching the stuff. And I will say that as much as I know you wanted to be down there, you weren't there, and I know you were there. I would submit to you that as much as it might have been fun to be at the circus live, it was way better to be at home watching it and listening to Mike Tyson calling a fight. It was. I mean, really, from the time that Tyson stepped to the mic and then through the Kimbo Dada 5000 bout, the main event really, there wasn't much there that, you know, it was just a miscall by an official, whatever. But for that time when those two other the co-man and the one right before it were happening, it was joy. I mean, I was actually having the best time. I was sitting there laughing and giggling. You know, my wife likes it. What are you watching? And I was just like, you know, so that was great. But then there's the time when we have to sober up. And that was when we find out that Dada 5000 had a cardiac arrest and renal failure and is in the hospital and apparently is still in the hospital. I mean, at some point we realize that it's all fun and games until someone gets hurt. And not just hurt in the sense of like everybody who steps in the cage in any kind of fight has a chance of hurting themselves. But this was a guy that really shouldn't have been stepping into a professional fight. He just had the Texas Commission just really should not have been allowing this guy into a fight like that. Yeah. And so I step away with a pretty bad feeling about the whole thing. But I got to say, while it was happening, I was like giddy as hell.
Well, it was fun. It was giddy. But you realize it was a fun, giddy, near snuff film that we were watching. I mean, that's insane to sort of think about because that's how it sort of played out. That's how it seemed afterwards when you realize just how serious it had gotten for that guy, that he almost died after that fight. It was pretty crazy. I mean, the bottom line was, I think most people, I would assume that everybody thought that it was maybe the first exchange or two, and somebody was going to go down because this is just what they did. It got so comically tragic after that takedown and both
guys. It went from comic to tragic.
Yeah, it went from comic to tragic and then back. It sort of went back and forth. Yeah. But it was like when you saw how dead tired both were after that whole exchange and the realization that you still had a full fight, you're like, okay, wait, can either one of these guys now finish the other? That was my first thing because that you think that's going to happen early. And if not, how sad is this thing going to play out? Because, and that was, you know, you said, I know people were laughing in the crowd and stuff because it actually did have some very comical, but also, you know, whatever you want to call it, but it was bizarre. It was a fun communal experience on Twitter because I know I was feeling the same thing. I thought everybody was sort of having fun with it. In some ways, I guess that was kind of the point of having a fight like that. I don't know if they quite wanted to go the directions it did, but I was real torn, but I will say this. In the aftermath, when you realize it came that close to something tragic happening, what a stupid sacrifice that would have been to a sport that has fought this hard to get to where it's at. The whole thing starts to crumble at that point. I really believe that. One stupid casualty, like one stupid moment where there's a casualty of that nature, like on big, like on TV like that, is enough to bring the whole thing down, in my opinion. And that's what I don't like. I don't like that.
I don't agree. And the reason why I don't agree is because prior to the fight, you knew that the guy's name is Dada 5000. Yes. I mean, how serious of an athlete could he possibly be against Kimbo Slice? But that was not where people were really interested in focusing their concerns. I was much more, and I most of the concern I saw pre-fight was about Hoist and Ken. You know, should geriatrics be fighting in the Legends division? Should they be fighting MMA? And so, to me, it'd be one thing if people had sounded the alarm. They went ahead, and then there was tragedy. It's very, very different if it doesn't happen until after the fact. But let me say something about Scott Coker's, what he's doing here, because it is a gimmick. The gimmick works when, if they had put that fight out, and about a minute later, Donna 5000 goes down. Kimbo's still huffing and puffing, but hey, it gets in, it gets out, it gets the job done. When it goes long, the whole bit in terms of how, you know, just how much of a gimmick it is laid totally bare.
Yeah, of course.
And when it got laid bare, you were like, oh, so this is what we're watching. And yet, after the fact, the ratings were 3.3 million for Kimbo Slice. So here's the question to you gentlemen. Are they going to bring him back? I don't see how they avoid it. Now, they might have to package it all very differently. But if someone asked you, who is the biggest star in Bellator? It is not Tito Ortiz. It is not Rampage Jackson. It is Kimbo Slice, unequivocally.
What was the pop like in Houston when he came out?
By far the biggest. Yeah. Not even a contest. And in fact, Dada got booed. He was the only guy who got booed on his walkout. What are they going to do? They have to keep using him, do they not?
I mean, I know I had fun in Houston, but I think next time you cover the Bellator card, they get Kimbo out there, they got to go to Mexico City. I think that, because Kimbo is one thing, but
Altitude Kimbo. I am not interested in the altitude Kimbo market.
No, they're going to put him in against somebody that maybe, who knows, you know, yeah. Tito Ortiz, somebody that's just one of their name guys that they think that will draw eyeballs. I mean, I think that we've seen that they will stop, you know, that Scott Coker will stop at nothing to attract eyeballs, to get people to pay attention. And so whatever they think is, they're going to do their research, they're going to figure out what people are most likely to want to see, and as far as I'm concerned, I'm not interested in seeing any of it.
Well, and the truth of the matter is, let's put it this way.
But a lot of people are.
But of course,
clearly. Kimbo Slice actually does have some merit. I mean, he did go through the, you know, he had some big fights. He went through the whole
tough
thing.
He's legit on some level.
So I'm like, it's not like the whole Dada fight. The freak show aspect was really by adding him. Obviously, Kimbo is part of this freak show, but the big aspect of that came in from his opponent. I feel like they could sort of eradicate some of that by booking him against a guy like Quentin Jackson or against Tito Ortiz or something like that, a guy who's like a former, you know, so Quentin's still kind of going, but, you know, Tito, who's kind of past any place he's going to return in any kind of real way, put those two together or something, it becomes a huge fight. Of course they're going to do it. I feel like Kimbo Slice, you know, it's like he did gas in this situation. He is an older fighter. I mean, he's been around for a long time, but he's still got it. I mean, in terms of like that sort of appeal. So I feel like, of course, because he has some merit behind him, because he's been around long enough, they're going to use him in one way or another. But hopefully they're putting him against a guy who's at least somewhat on that level.
I think, real quickly, I think one of the major takeaways that we need to talk about here in a way that is very, not like serious beard scratching, but like legitimately where there's a problem here. Eddie Alvarez is gone. Name a guy that Spike has turned into a star. Now, you could maybe argue Michael Chandler is certainly on his way, although those losses to Will Brooks kind of hurt him. But the point being is this. Everyone's like, they need to stop doing freak show fights. Yeah. In favor of what? And everyone's saying, if you go UFC light route and you're Bellator, you're going to go out of business in less than 2 years. Fact. There is no money in that market. But can you believe after the fact you had Dontis Galvao fall out this weekend, but it would have been ready for the last one. Darian Caldwell would have been ready for the last one. Can you believe, to me, one of the major takeaways is you're not transferring the audience from Kimbo down to everyone else at all. There's no pickup from the Kimbo halo to everyone else on the card. This, to me, among all the safety concerns, is a long-term promotional concern. They got to figure it out quick.
Well, the part of that I would take away is that, yes, it's a fact of life. They're going to have these fights, the legends fights, as Coker says, or the fun fights. I'm not sure which is fun, which is legend, but they're gonna have those. But why would you want to put two of those things on the one card? They've got a fight card tomorrow night. Well, now their main event dropped out. Wouldn't it have been smarter to have made, you know, Kimbo against Dada 5000 the main event tomorrow night, and Hoist against Shamrock the main event last week? That way you're going to get the casual eyeballs, the people who just want to watch that kind of stuff. They're going to watch, and they're also going to have an opportunity to see some of your fights and your real fighters, your fighters who are legitimate. And so I don't understand why they would stack two of them on top of each other. If you're going to do that, put one at the top and then fill the rest of it with your, you know, get Benson Henderson out there at some point.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, Scott Coker with Strikeforce, obviously, we had touched on this a little bit last week. I think Ariel had a very similar point, like, why aren't we shining the light on the young guys? If you're going to have that, have some kind of benefit to the guys below it to bring their star up. They really didn't do that. That is a little inexplicable, because when you really look at Scott Coker, I mean, when he was with Strikeforce, they had their star, they had their star players, and they didn't deepen the rosters so much. They just kind of put those star players in different shapes against one another. But they did have guys coming up through their like challenger series, like Luke Rockhold, for instance. They had guys. Obviously, Ronda Rousey came through this. They had lots of big name people.
And it takes time.
Yeah, it takes time. I feel like we're not seeing that quite yet. Some of the people that are sort of underneath, and maybe they should have shined, tried to get a shine on, you know, the Michael Pages, guys like this. Obviously, there's a lot of question marks with guys like him. They sign guys like Ed Ruth and Aaron Pico, who are just not there yet. I feel like they're looking to the future somewhat, but they're just not, it's not in cohesion yet. They're not really marrying the two. It's nice when they pick up guys like Benson Henderson, but it's a little puzzling when they don't go after a guy like Aljamain Sterling, like, because to me that's a guy who sort of fits all those gaps, a guy who could be somewhat of a star, not like a big time rating star, but a star enough to kind of get things rolling for you that way. It's a tough space. We used to talk about this way a year or two ago, and maybe during the Bjorn, you said it was UFC and then it's a distant gulf between the next one. Well, this is their only way, like you said, kind of putting on these, staging these kind of freaks to get where, you know, on the same level essentially, or the same level in terms of ratings and things like that. Very tough. Scott Coker, I feel like they're trying to figure it out. They're trying to bridge the gap, but obviously we're seeing some glaring things that they're doing wrong, too.
And just imagine if, now I know the main event for tomorrow night dropped out, but let's imagine that main event were still happening. That's a real good fight.
It's a legit fight.
Real good fight.
By any measurement.
What kind of ratings were they going to get?
Oh, I guarantee you less than 600,000.
Right, yeah. Right. So why not have, you know, take your legend or your fun fights, spread them out, have one on at the top of every one of these cards. Go crazy with it, but then have your other guys, and that is how you're going to build it, because you're not going to build by putting these fights in the main event, because people just don't want to, you know, you're not going to get the same kind of eyeballs. And, you know, but if you actually have them as the co-main, you know, that's going to get you maybe a little attention.
You know what's funny about this last one too? I don't know how much you paid attention to it if you went back and watched the fights, but Jimmy Smith, who's the color commentator, had basically voiced his frustration somewhat, even on air, sort of like, oh my God. He went on Twitter afterwards and was FML, you know, like, I can't believe this sort of thing. He was on Ariel's show on Monday, and he was basically pointing out this very conundrum, like, you know what? I want, personally, to put these guys on there. You know, you want to have the guys that are their star, their guys that they're bringing up. But he made the point, I don't remember exactly which fight, did 800,000 viewers during it, and it was a title fight, and it was like the one where Chandler was on there against a caveman. It was like that whole card. He's like, it was Pitbull. It was a Pitbull fight. He said it did 800,000 viewers, and then he's like, they talked about Ken and Kembo doing 2.2, and he's like, he got kind of heated on the show, not, you know, but worked up saying, like, it's not us, it's you guys, it's the fans who dictate this. If the ratings are there, the people who are in the suits up top are just like, hey, this is what we do. This is the formula. This is how we do it. And it's funny to see, like, internally there's frustration too. Like, I'm sure that there are plenty of people within Bellator's organization that would love to create their own stars and then have those guys be where they're at. I just think that, like you mentioned before, because that's really the thing, where the UFC's at and where they need to be to compete, that's a tough thing to bridge.
Very quickly, in terms of the Dana 5000 health scare, who is responsible? We know Dana 5000 has a personal responsibility, the commission has a responsibility, and Bellator. Very quickly for you both, because we're getting short on time here. Who is the most responsible?
The commission. Absolutely. You know, Bellator, that's the promotion. They're going to try to put together a fight that's going to sell, right? Dana 5000, he's the guy who's getting an opportunity to make a lot of money. Not to take away any guilt from either one of them, but the commission is the one that has to be in charge of making sure a fight is safe.
Yeah.
They sent me, Bellator sent me the whole form that they had, that all the fighters had to fill out, and the only difference that, they were really sending me because of the Hoist Gracie Ken Shamrock fight, the only difference between the typical health form and the one that any fighter over 36 years old has to do is they both have to get an EKG and an EEG. So they basically had to get a brain scan and a heart scan. So that was it. There was no other stuff. And, you know, these commissions need to they're not, you know, they're the ones that are supposed to be the watchdogs. Why are they there if they're not ensuring health?
It's the commission. I think it's got to be the commission. I mean, the Bellator, any promotion, their thing is just to, like, to test taste, maybe, like, to If they want to be distasteful, they can bring it to the commission, but it's the commission's job to shut it down if they don't like it.
By the way, I just want to make a note. Bellator does a thing that UFC does not do. It drives me crazy. I want to put it on the air. Bellator, if you're in the media, will seat you behind a row of VIPs. And I had a guy who kept standing in front of me the whole time, and I asked him to sit down. And he looks at me and he says, I paid $1,000 for these seats. And I looked him dead in his face, and I go, then enjoy your seats.
Yeah.
Jerk face.
They need to address that media section. Guys trying to buy my hat last time I was at it.
It's either here nor there. I just wanted to mention it. Quickly, with the time we have remaining, also on that Saturday was World Series of Fighting 28. Marlon Moraes fighting in looked like a place where there's hippies playing hacky sack and the homeless loitering inside a place, I am not kidding you, unironically titled the Next Level Sports Complex. Wow, that
was amazing.
The reason
they call Garden Grove Garbage Grove, and I think you just touched on it.
Unbelievable, right? Here's the question real quickly for you guys. Where is World Series of Fighting? Where are we headed with this place? It seems to me that, like, once Bellator was taken over by Scott Coker, the promotional side of that, whatever we think about it, is just completely overshadowing what they're doing. You're seeing more guys disaffected over there. What's going on?
I think it was really symbolic that we had a Friday night big spectacle circus Bellator thing that drew ratings like crazy. And as soon as that ended, what did people start thinking about other than, you know, Data 5000's health? The next thing they started thinking about is, ooh, there's that Cowboy versus Cowboy happening on Sunday night. It was like we were just skipping right over Saturday. And Saturday night is the night when the big fights are supposed to happen, right? Not Friday night, not Sunday night. Saturday is prime time for fighting. And nobody was paying attention to it. I mean, I DVR'd it and watched some of it, you know, fast-forwarded through a lot of it, watched a lot of it. But there's no anticipation at all. I think that they're lost. They're adrift. They're not looking. They don't have a direction.
Not to suggest they'd ever been at the top, like where they were ever like really competing with these other entities. But have you guys seen Spinal Tap?
No. Let's go back a little bit. Hold on before you finish. I remember when they were putting on Arlovski versus Johnson. Doing big headlines.
They've had moments. Well, anyways, maybe that's the wrong way to preface it. But have you seen Spinal Tap where they sort of show their glory at the beginning and then by the end they're playing like these ridiculous shows where nobody's there? That's what it reminds me of. It's like this sort of comically, I don't know.
They're going to be in a coffee shop next.
Yeah, that's what it felt like. I know our Dave Doyle took a picture of a volleyball game going on, essentially with the cage out there distantly behind it. And I was thinking, now we've reached the new low.
The next level. This.
Yeah.
The next level. I mean, there's like elderly swimming courses going on to treat like osteoporosis right next to the. I just feel like, if you look at World Series of Fighting's roster, they got a lot of good guys on there. They got an upcoming fight with, I think, Justin Gaethje, who we all have a tremendous amount of respect for.
Yeah.
It's not that they don't have quality guys. It's that promotionally, now that Bellator has changed, it has left World Series of Fighting with really no pitch
and no
to stick out.
Right, and they haven't had one. The fact that they even kind of go after the big stars, like I know that, I think it was Aljamain Sterling was saying that he had an offer from World Series of Fighting. They're trying,
right?
But it's just, I really feel like they have no identity. It's very difficult, I would say, at this point for them to lure free agents on just money alone. I think on some levels, maybe some guys will do that, but you've got to have some kind of
bantamweight champion fighting in a next level down sports complex.
Yeah.
I mean, that's unconscionable, really,
yes,
if you think about it.
Is.
All right. Well, as gruesome and as horrible as that discussion is, not quite gruesome, but, you know, unfun, let's end on a positive note.
All right.
There is, we mentioned before, Bisping versus Silva this weekend. The main event was lost, unfortunately, for you, Bellator 150, Dantas versus Galvao 2, so we can't include that. But I guess Ariel always likes to end on a positive note by asking, which fight are you looking forward to the most? We will keep that tradition alive while he is not here. I'll start backwards and work forwards.
Oh, good.
Chuck. What is the fight you're looking forward to most?
And
this
can't say Silva against Bisping because to me that's the one I'm looking most.
You
kind of
already said it a little bit there.
Well, I mean, there are some compelling fights.
Wow,
I don't
look
like,
at you.
I don't feel like there's a ton of really great ones. Like, I don't feel like there's that one compelling fight. But
you're,
I guess,
so wrong.
Well, you like to break these fights down a lot more than me. But I would say that the Norman Park fight probably, like, this is because of their bad blood that they kind of generated a little bit. And it's always a fun fight. To me, that matchup makes some sense.
Okay.
All right. I'll go with the co-main. I mean, Musasi was supposed to be fighting Bisping. He's not. And he's still in a big stage. So, I'm looking forward to seeing what he can produce.
These are both the incorrect answers. I will give the correct one.
We haven't had a correct answer all day.
Yeah,
no, of course not. Not when I'm around.
Another show with no correct answers.
It is the return of Tom Breeze, who sparked out Cathal Pendred. He's taking on Kaito Nakamura. Nakamura has fought, I think, three times in the UFC. He's never won. But he's a really solid, Sengoku journeyman, I believe, and a dream journeyman as well. Here's what I mean. You get these prospects, and they get so hot, they get a fight way too early in their development. I feel like with Breeze, were getting just enough of him at just the right time. And he looked tremendous against Pendred. Yeah. Led to Pendred getting some of the worst Twitter hate I think I've ever
look
seen.
At you digging through the back racks of vinyl, trying to find the indie classics.
I like to get the deep cuts, the B sides.
Right.
But that's my pick. Right. But there's a few decent picks out there if you guys are interested. There is Bellator tomorrow night. Again, unfortunately, lacking that main event. Then, of course, we're going to have wall-to-wall coverage of Bisping versus Silva. We have the creative duo on the ground there, Esther and Casey. And you guys know Ariel is always staying busy. So we encourage you to keep watching those videos and all of our coverage. So I guess that's it.
Yeah.
Are we going to be back next week?
I think so.
I don't even know. Well, that's how plugged in I am to this show. For Chuck, for Jeff, and, of course, Ariel, who can't be here, but I'm sure we'll be here very soon. I am Luke. Thank you for watching the MMA Beat.